Hello, and welcome. You are about to enter the Large K Podcast. What's up, everybody? My name is Kazu, and welcome to another episode of Large K Podcast. On this show, I interview interesting bands and artists, and we have conversation about their music, influences, and how they got to where they're at. For this episode, I had conversation with my friend Jonathan, aka J-Dub. We went to high school together, and he's a very talented guy. He's a hip-hop artist in Los Angeles, and has a mixtape out called ALMOST FAMOUS MIXTAPE. We haven't seen each other for about 9 years, so yeah, there was so much to talk about. I was able to catch up with him and learned about his true dedication to music. Alright, here's the interview I did with Jonathan, aka J-Dub. Enjoy.
Kids like rock and roll because it's tough. Why do you think
rock is the rhythm of death and hell?
Yeah.
And without that rhythm, rock is the rhythm of death and hell. And without that rhythm, rock is the rhythm of death. Rock is the rhythm of death and rock is the rhythm of death and hell. And without that rhythm, death and hell.
Kids, let's go take a vacation to the place you get taken after self-asphyxiation. You think peace won't save you, you're deceased, you bitch. Your words are useless, maybe next time try some stuff.
I haven't been there in a while.
Right, yeah.
I would go there for shows sometimes. But.
Right, yeah. But I mean, I don't know. I feel like you're already doing your own thing, and it's kind of, it's just really incredible just because, like, you're, because I've seen you doing so much shit, and now all of a sudden, like, I see you as a rapper now.
Yeah.
That... Yeah, I don't know, like, I didn't expect that for some reason, I don't know, because I seen you play at the, sorry, I'm just going to check this.
People don't know, did you go to BV, though,
high
school, or what elementary school did you go to?
I went to Hawthorne.
Oh, okay, weird, because, like, low-key, I was doing rap shit when I was at, like, BV, but it was, like, I can talk about it or whatever in the interview, but it was, like, parody rap shit.
Oh, parody
like, I would
rap?
Do like but I would do, like, talent shows.
Right, yeah, yeah.
And I would do, like... Anyways, like, I would just do some talent show shit, and it was, like... I mean, I don't know if people remember it or not, but,
right,
like,
yeah.
At the time, got, like, a lot of applause and stuff like that.
Yeah, yeah.
And that, like, that rapping right now for me is, like, drawing on this, like, on that, like, older... childhood like experiences and stuff where I'm like I know I can do this because I did it when I was like 10.
Right.
It's like super goofy but like yeah but it's real, you know.
Yeah I mean recorder's on right now, so I mean
okay,
we don't necessarily have any like proper introduction or whatever.
What is the podcast usually? You don't be like, all right, oh, we're here with like
I mean because podcast is basically like a pre-recorded material, so like all it is like, you know, I stick everything together like sure. Afterwards, so this is
chop
just like a, yeah, this is just a casual conversation.
That's cool. All right,
yeah, putting it no together problem. Yeah, so that's pretty cool though. Wait, because when you were saying about talent show, is it kind of like, because you said parody rap, so is it kind of like Weird Al style?
Here's
shit?
What I did. Okay, here's yeah. What I did. Okay. It was like I rap, and this also was like I used to do it at like summer camp too.
Yeah.
So what I would do was like, you know, like when Eminem was really big.
Yeah.
And it was like Lose Yourself was the song. I guess basically, basically the what I was doing at the talent shows, talent show was that like I combined like Lord of the Rings with like rap, and it was like me rapping about like Lord of the, like it was like at the time the Lord of the Rings movies were coming out.
Yeah.
And so it was like, it was just like on like a pop culture thing, and so it was like I would do like Lose Yourself, but it would be about like the Twin Towers when they came out, or Two Towers, I mean.
Yeah.
And And then like I had one where I'm like, I'm a HOBBIT, like instead of like PIMP, and this was like big hits at Beverly Vista. You know, yeah, but like only a little bit. To be honest, it was just like, I don't think people remember it except for a few. Like, there are some random people from Beverly who were like younger who like remember and who have like found me in later years and been like, dude, like, really? You're PIMP or you're HOBBIT. Like, only a few people though. Shouts out Juliana.
are there any recorded materials of those songs by any chance?
That's a good question. And maybe. Mm. But I feel like my parents might have that. I don't know. Actually, I feel like 40%, yeah. Like, probably not, but maybe. I don't know if anybody got that. But then, yeah, in, like, summer camp and stuff, used to be doing that. And so, like, what I'm doing now with like, rapping and stuff is mm-hmm. that it's, like, that's what it means to me. I feel like it looks really bizarre to people, but, like, that's okay. But, like, that I'm, like, drawing on, like, it's, like, a full representation of myself, like, based on this, like, really early years of joke rap or something.
Mm-hmm.
But then that's the whole thing, is that nowadays, like, people are always comparing me to Lil Dicky, basically.
What, really?
That's yeah, that's which, like, all the time, like, all the time, or, like, friends of mine, and they're like, yo, you should link up with Lil Dicky, but it's, like, the whole point that I'm trying to make is that it's not, like, the shit I'm doing now, it's not parody rap, it's not, like, a joke, and it's, like, coming from a serious place.
Yeah, because I never looked at it, that's kind of weird how people just compares you with Lil Dicky, because first person that I thought of when I heard you rapping...
Mm-hmm.
Especially I got it through kind of like the high pitched voice that you kind of create. You know that the first track off of the Almost Famous mixtape, that cat song.
Uh huh.
Yeah, you remind me a lot of Danny Brown for some reason.
Okay, tight. Yeah. I felt like I was kind of going into those zones.
Yeah.
Just when I was recording, like, that's so cool that you say that, Kazu. Thank you, man.
No, that's the first thing I thought, is that, because even with the experimental side, I mean, it's not as experimental as like Death Grips per se, but
right.
You know, but you still kind of have this flow and this kind of silliness that Danny Brown delivers, and I feel like that was like the person that I feel like I kind of relate to.
Hey, dude, John. I appreciate yeah. that, and I feel like I mean, to be honest, I think I'm trying to like craft my own voice, like I'm trying, and I'm of excited course, yeah. for the next like projects and stuff that I'm doing, that I think it's gonna be more like I'm just like, yeah, I'm working on having more of my own voice. But I think at the time, like, that it's not that I was trying to like do Danny Brown or something, but I feel like when I was recording it, like I was just recording it by myself pretty much.
Of course,
but I could feel myself like going to those places, like that same kind of like wavelength or something yeah, that he's yeah, yeah. on. And so yeah, like I feel that that's like, but that's only I don't even know, not that's only, but just yeah, I also want to be making like kind of turn up rap, but that can be appreciated like both by like hip hop people and also like more like art, more avant garde or something.
Yeah, I mean, nowadays it's definitely appreciated by like so many different people. So I don't know, like trap, like turn up rap is like the thing now. Like whether your lyrics are good or not, you know, it's kind of like
right.
It's kind of gone down that way. I mean, I don't know, Ray Shrimmer is probably like a turn up rap, and then yeah, it's not, they're not the most lyrical people out there, you know, like, so it's kind of funny how
right.
how that's like the big thing. So but,
like
yeah
I mess with it though, like I like Ray Shrimmer.
Yeah, no, Ray Shrimmer is they're a lot of fun to listen to. I mean, I always catch myself listening to like a lot of turn up music a lot. But I was wondering, since I kind of want to kind of put it talk about your beginning in music, and just to get to know you even more from here, because when I first saw you in high school, you were so active and just a lot of shit. Like, one, you were part of choir, you were doing theater, you're part of dance company, you were You're also in a band, right? I mean, weren't you playing drums?
What? Jackrabbit Slims.
That was the name of the band.
Yeah, Jackrabbit Slims, and we actually just met up last night, like with my cousin David, and then Johnny Cat, and Brandon Raffison. Uh-huh. That was the band. But yeah, we all met up me, Dave, and Johnny were just kicking it last night, but we listened to the Jackrabbit Slims.
Oh, really?
Like, songs that we had last night, and it's like, yeah, those were good times. We were just reminiscing. But yeah, so yeah, I did have a bunch going on, like, in high school.
Yeah.
And I think that those times, but especially vocally, I mean, because I'm also, like, a singer, and I was making, like, kind of acoustic, more like singer-songwriter music for a while before I started doing rap, and like I'm kind of trying to over time I'm trying to make it so that like I can be an artist that like does everything, that does all of that,
of course,
and
yeah,
like incorporates it all together, and I feel like, yeah, the high school years were like a good pressure cooker where I was like doing a lot of different things, and now I guess I can draw on those things.
Yeah, what was your first instrument?
First instrument was drums.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah, first instrument was drums, and also drums is the only instrument that I've had, like, lessons in.
Oh, okay.
Like, full, like, for years, though, for a bunch of years. I started when I was, like, 10 or something, right, and, like, yeah, like, not trained, but just, like, had lessons, you know what I mean?
Right,
and,
yeah.
Then I just picked up guitar from there, and...
Guitar was DIY, though, right? I mean...
Yeah, exactly, yeah, like, yeah, picked up guitar, my... When we were jamming at that time, before we had an actual band, like, some friend of my cousin's, like, left his guitar at my house, and I just, like, learned how to play it, basically. And then now I am a guitarist in a band for Amelia Harris, shout out, who also went to Beverly.
Oh, really? Okay. Oh, wait, no, yeah, that's right. Because that's, like, your side project at the moment, is just playing with Amelia?
For sure. It's kind of both, though. Like, I mean, me and Amelia have been working together for a bunch of years, and like right now you'll see this year all of our projects are gonna surface.
Oh, wow.
Which is basically her, it's her, but I'm like have been producing some of it, and I'm playing guitar in the band.
Hmm.
And I treat them both like seriously, though. It's not, neither one is kind of like a side project. I'm just trying to treat them both seriously, and at least right now I have like the this awesome situation where I can kind of like flex myself musically in a lot of different directions.
Right, yeah.
And
yeah,
I'm just trying to like just get better in all the different like well-rounded ways or something. Just get better in all the different ways. So
Yeah. I remember I don't know how long ago it was, but maybe like a few years ago, I thought you released an album before Almost Mixtape. It was kind of like a more folky sound thing. I think it was called like The Perfect Storm.
Yeah
Is that, because I was actually trying to look for that like a few days ago, but it wasn't around, so I don't know, like is that still available online, or is that
that's a good question.
Is that not,
I
like
took
a...
I took it down because it,
really?
it was on like DatPiff.
Uh-huh.
I guess it was like one place where it existed, and I don't know, no, I took it down to like just focus on like rap stuff or something.
Okay.
Or just be like, I don't know, but that's good, like that I'm glad that you have heard it and stuff. And I mean, that's something that's like behind the scenes or something, like I could burn it for you, you know what I mean?
Oh, okay.
Or something, like if you wanted to. And I don't know, yeah, like that's cool that you bring it up. I took it down because basically I don't know who, I mean, maybe that's my own problem, I don't know who's like following my music,
right?
And I was hoping, I keep just thinking like, okay, it's not with this thing, maybe it didn't work, but I'm gonna come back, like I'm trying to build up over time, like just the presentation of stuff, and just kind of like the more professional like sound and production,
yeah,
like et cetera, et cetera. So that project was like basically that was like one of the first things that I like really finished as like an album.
Yeah.
And I feel like it's just kind of like raw, and I don't know if, and also it's honestly, it has to do with like cohesive, like the way people like find out about artists, and like people kind of want their the artist to be like cohesive, for them to understand it, for people to understand.
Yeah.
So like, the fact that you know about that Perfect Storm is really cool, but it's on a, it's almost on some shit where I feel like if people are just finding out about me like now and like over time, it's gonna happen where like I'm gonna bring in those elements of like the more folky stuff and more like songwriting or something, or like psychedelic or more rock or whatever. Like I'm gonna bring it in over time with the music is like what I'm thinking basically.
Okay.
So that by the end, like I can be do like my full the full thing, but like, but anyways, yeah. So I basically I took that stuff offline though.
Okay, so that people could focus more on the rapping stuff that you've been doing.
Yeah, and then exactly.
Eventually, over time, you'll put out your like other genre stuff. But I think I thought the because there was a last track off of the Almost Famous mixtape that was a rock song though.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So that's what I'm trying to do is like hint at it, and it's on some shit where it's like. Perfect Storm, that was like the more like rock album. The rock album has like a hip hop end track to it, which was sensitive to my aura.
Yeah.
And then like now, like the rap mixtape has like a rock song at the end of it, or like a folk song or something. And like that's, yeah, that's kind of how I'm doing it. But honestly, like it's just I didn't realize at first how long it takes to like finish projects, basically, like just in music that, and in order to do it well, it takes just like. Like time basically to like just nail all the things and get it sounding really right. So I would say that's what I've kind of been focusing on over the years, and it's kind of been frustrating because I wish I could just like bang it. Like I already know like all the songs and stuff.
Right.
I wish I could just like bang it out, just like boom boom, and just be done with it. But instead, it's like okay, like you'll just have to wait like a while to like for me to like get all that shit out and do it well, because. Yeah, Perfect Storm, that was, like, the first thing that I ever, like, really recorded by myself as, like, a intentional, like, to do an album. So, I just think, like, I mean, I hope people listen to it and check it out.
Because I remember when it came out, it was even on, like, YouTube and stuff, and just kind of checking out a few tracks. It was just kind of like this folky... Just really folky, yeah, just like what you said about very raw material, you know what I mean? So then, so when you took it down, in my head, I kind of thought maybe he was dissatisfied with the result, or like, and I just wasn't too sure.
I mean, I guess I feel like the response, I feel like, I don't know, nah, maybe I'm just thinking of certain people, like, but some of the response I got was just that it wasn't produced, like it wouldn't be able to stand next to shit that's produced really well to be just like really big and stuff like that. And so it made me feel like, okay, maybe I want to revisit it like later or something, or like re-record some of the sounds or something like that,
right? Yeah.
And also like that's kind of what I'm coming in on right now though, honestly, is like that like part of my approach to rap music and stuff is kind of like on a low-key, like it's like coming from the folk songwriter thing or something, but I keep kind of like sometimes bringing in like a Charles Manson like reference or something in vibe, but only on the idea that it's like a folk singer. It's like, yo, I used to be a folk singer, but like they didn't understand me, like they didn't hear the words, like they didn't hear my words, so like I had to just put it to them in a way that they could understand, and like the inner, just bring out the inner rage, you know what I mean, instead of trying to like cover it up with like you know, pretty chords and like lyrics and stuff, just like bring, and that's also, by the way, like that I went into college like writing all those songs, like I went into college like writing a lot more songs on guitar, and then over time like the music that was coming to me, like instead of it being like lyrical and whatnot, was just kind of more like intense and just fucking like, no, because it's shit is super saturated with, I mean, both are okay, honestly though, both shit is saturated, like singer songwriter stuff saturated, also rap music is very saturated, so it's not like that's not really the main thing, but it's just like this feeling that like I was kind of hanging out, I think, with more like songwriter musicians, just more like rock based musicians, yeah, and stuff, yeah, and people writing songs, and that I was just seeing a lot of shit where I feel like they're just like not being honest or something,
right,
or some shit where it's just like the classic like everybody wants to, like, yo, I'm a mysterious singer-songwriter, like, playing behind my guitar, like, you know, or some shit, which, honestly, there's nothing wrong with that, and I still, like, really appreciate that music, but, and I, like, I wanted, you know, I would still enjoy writing songs, but at the same time, like, I'm just, like, knowing, like, a lot of my music, honestly, is, like, based on some shit where I'm just, like, what if, like, because, like, what if somebody did this, what if this, like, nobody does this, nobody, like, there's no, and even though it's really, like, an obscure thing, like, I want to see it, like, I'm, like, what would it be like if there was this, like, musician that came out and they were a singer-songwriter, but right, then they're just like, yo, I just started rapping instead, because they're, like, I don't give a fuck, like, this is how I really feel, and they're just like, yo, my lines are really poetic, like, suck my dick, like, I'm up in the coffee shop, like, I don't know, just, like, and, like, and I'm gonna keep that going, low-key, you know, if people are listening in the future, whatever, like, I'm gonna drop a song, I'm gonna want to do a song that's called, like, Your Folk Music is Trash,
no, okay,
you know, because it's just low-key shit where, like, sometimes, man, it's just funny to me, like, being around people who are so, like, deep up their own, like, into their music that, like, I'm just saying, like, I don't know what, I've been in, like, you know, like, a lot of, like, underground shows and DIY, like, events and stuff and, like, campfires and things where there's, like, there is a low-key tension, like, there's super low-key tension, just in terms of, like, people and their music and their, like, artistry and, like, stuff like that, and I guess, like, me personally, like, I don't want to feel that, and I just want to, like, feel relieved and stuff and just feel comfortable with myself, right? Like, it's not important to me, like, whether, like, people think that I'm, like, the deepest or not or what or something, and it's just, like, some stuff that I just think is funny, and no one ever writes any songs about that, and I do, and I do want some of my stuff to be funny and, like, kind of comical, but it's, like, funny because it's serious, because it's just talking about this thing, like, this tension, let's say, with, like, songwriters or, like, coffee shop songwriters, and it's, like, okay, just, like, low-key tension, and I want to be the dude that goes up there and is just, like, yeah, I'm the number one dude, like, my songs are limitless, like, man, like, fucking shut you down, I take your girl, man, with my deep songs, I don't know, that's, like, kind of, that is kind of where I'm coming from or something, is, like, the inspiration of, like, the wellspring of, like, where is my inspiration coming from, is just, like, what if this person did this, like, what if Tom York, because, like, okay, also, I'm just ranting, Kazu.
No, that's fine, you can keep going with it, too, yeah.
You can stop me, we can change subject, but, like, honestly, dude, like, that, like, okay, because, like, that with rap music and stuff, there's, like, a huge, like, racial component, right?
Yeah.
And, like, definitely. And just, like, that basically, though, I'm, like, what if, though, so sometimes I think, like, okay, you know, all the different music, the whole music world, and it's, like, for songwriters and, like, white people especially or whatever, I don't know,
right.
It's, like, who's number one, like, because, like, that, like, rap and hip-hop is more competitive, and so I would say, like, right now, you know, number one in, like, the songwriter world, I don't know, anyways, number one is Radiohead, is Tom York, it's like Tom York's at the top or something in terms of who are people trying to sound like, right, music, like, who do people kind of, like, look to try to sound like, maybe, whatever, in my mind, is like Tom York's number one,
definitely influential for sure, I mean, the top list,
and it's just like, yeah. What if, though, instead of, like, I'm just imagining, like, a alternate scenario where instead of, like, Tom York just kind of, like, being in his zen, like, head down mode and being all zen and shit, he's just like, nah, I'm fucking Tom York, dog, like, fucking suck it, you already know, like, bitch, like, you know what I mean, and just being like, yeah, like, I'm embracing it, because it's like, it has to do with some kind of, like, tradition of, like, of what, shoegaziness, maybe, like, sometimes friends will say that I was, like, playing a lot of shoegaze music, quote-unquote, but it's just kind of this vibe of, like, kind of this melancholy aspect.
Okay.
That I guess I feel like, I don't know, like, I was coming from, or people, I'm just like, what if people who made, like, melancholy music, instead of being melancholy, just, like, let it out in a more intense way of, like, right, how they really feel, and then, like, turned it into, like, party music, basically.
Actually, I wanted to speak on, within that rant, like, when you're talking about Tom York just, like, fucking busting out and rapping or whatever. Yeah, yeah. There's actually, what was it? There's a song on there called Kanye, Don't Let Me...
Yo, Kanye Let Me Down.
Kanye Let Me Down.
Yeah.
Paul McCartney just stood up and started.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Did you like that?
That was funny. Like,
okay.
it just came out of nowhere. I was like, what the fuck's going on?
Yo, no, I appreciate that. Yeah, because, like, Yeah, also, Tom York, if you hear this, man, I'm trying to rap battle. Like, let's do this, dude.
Oh, shit.
What's yeah, I'm trying to start beef. Trying to start some beef with Tom York.
Yeah. Are you really... Did Kanye really let you down? And
well, kind of. Like, I... you know, the full story is that, like, one time when he started Donda, and this was probably in, like, 2011 or something like that, and he put up on Twitter, and it, I think it got reported on Pitchfork and stuff. He's like, you know... open applications for Donda to work on his creative team.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? And I felt inspired, and I was like, you know, looking for something to do. I would have loved to have been a part of it, and I feel like what I'm trying to do now is like prove that I'm really creative, prove that I'm really creative, and that I'm able to produce like these large scale high quality productions.
Yeah.
And you know, like, anyway, so I wrote out this like long email that was like pretty I mean, honestly, I don't know if I could find it anymore, but it was like kind of weird, but I was like really put my heart into it. I definitely spent some time, and I sent Kanye the email, and then he never got back to me, you know what I mean? And yeah. it's like why is it that when somebody, you know, tries to reach out, like, to greatness and is also great and then is, like, denied, you know what I mean? And it's, like, anyways, it's just funny because Kanye's, because actually, overall, I'm on Team Ye. Yeah. And I have arguments with family, friends, and people on the street about what the fuck Kanye does. Because I guess I'll say it here that I think he just doesn't, he's not putting it the right way. Like, I think the messages behind, like, the messages that he's trying to get across to people, I'm, like, down with. But, like, the way he does it is always fucking terrible and, right. like, not effective in actually getting his shit across. And, anyways, I'm just saying that, like, he's just always had this thing from the beginning. And I was just trying to, like, kind of make fun of it in the track where he's just, like... like, just out Kanye, like, he's, like...
You sounded like Kanye, too, like...
Yeah, like, yeah, thanks, like, man. No, just, like, because his thing is this, he's just, like, oh, fuck, okay, wait, this is kind of on the spot. Also, P.S., the, J. Cole, do you see the J. Cole, he put out a song that's called, like, False Prophet? Prophets.
Yeah, that's a good song.
Yeah, exactly. So, already there's people, like... way of that are getting more play than me, like, challenging Kanye and whatnot, but I hope and, you know, I'd be curious if it ever gets to him or something like that. Yeah. But anyways, Kanye let me down. It's just the thing, like, where he's like, I'm kind of blanking because I just, like, defended him and shit, but it's just how he, like, He's just like, man, like, if only they would get behind me. It's also, Drake kind of does that, too. It's just like, man, if only, like, everybody would just get behind me and give me a chance. It's like, dude, what chance do you need? Like, you're fucking killing. You're at a certain position, dude. Like, you can do a lot of things, you know what I mean? And he's just like, man, like, why don't, like... just like as if the whole fucking world were just supposed to like get, oh, Kanye, wait, what do you want? You want this? Like, oh my God, I didn't even realize. Like, I don't know, like, oh, I just never thought of it that way. And he's just like, yeah, I know you didn't. Like, I don't know, like, it's just that vibe is like really, it's funny to me, like, since the beginning, like, his vibe where he's like super sentimental, and he's just like, man. But I don't know. At the same time, like, it's not even... I'm not even, like, anti-Ye. Like, I hope we can meet and be cool.
Yeah, the
funny... It was out of love. It was... That whole track's out of love. And also, it's, like, some shit that, just in case... Because that J. Cole thing hadn't come out yet. So, just in case nobody was trying to call Kanye on his shit, like, I was out there being, like,
J-Dub's dog. J-Dub's the first one. Yeah.
Being, like, dog.
You know what's funny? Probably the funniest thing you said on the song was... I still remember it pretty well, but you said My Dark Beautiful Twisted Fantasy is far from perfect or something like that.
Yeah, Dark Twisted Fantasy, by the way, is overrated in my opinion. That's just my opinion, but like, everybody just, like, jizzed themselves when that came out, I guess, in the music community.
No, yeah, Pitchfork gave it, like, a 10 or something.
10
like
out
that.
Of 10.
Yeah.
Because they got played, in my opinion. Whatever. His rollout for that was really good. Like, that's in my opinion. Like, his rollout, because the Good Fridays were, like, really good leading up to that.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, just Dark Twisted Fantasy. Yeah, but I can't speak for everybody. Like, I feel like, you know, it's more of like a hit, maybe it's more of a hip hop head thing. People are like, that's a perfect rap album. You know what I mean? But, like, honestly, just to put it on record, like, Dark Twisted Fantasy, there's so much certain shit in there is like, really, dude? Like, for lyrics, like, really, dude? He's like, I call you bitch for short. Like, you call me motherfucker for long. Like, people are like, it's like, that's what Kanye's on, and maybe that's what's funny to me. Like, I'm down with it sometimes, but he's like, that's poetry. He's like, think about it. That's real. That's poetry. It's like, dude, like, can't you think of any inventive words? Anyways, Runaway, like, to me, like, Runaway, the song Runaway is, like, the most beautiful beat, like, the whole thing with the piano and stuff. Like, the beat and the music is beautiful, but, like, literally the song is, like, let's have a toast to the assholes.
Yeah.
Like, that's the song. That is the song. And, like, I don't know, like, I guess that I feel like, I mean, I think actually a lot of people feel this way, but it's, like, Kanye has, like, he had the chance to, like, be a better person with that, and, like, why is he toasting the asshole? Like, you know what I mean? Like, why is he, like, he's, like, giving a praise to bad people. Just, like, straight up, like, bad people. Let's like, give it up for them. Like, I can't get... I just can't get behind that in reality, like... Or maybe I can if it was more poetic, but if you're just, like... Just being, like, yeah, toast the douchebags... And then, like, that's where he's at, or that has been his thing for a minute. It's like, toast the douchebags. Poetry.
What are your thoughts on Life of Pablo?
I actually really like Life of Pablo.
Yeah, I like it too. It's
Life of Pablo is actually my favorite Kanye album.
Really?
Period. Yeah, actually, wow. Overall, I think so, yeah.
Usually people say, like, Late Registration or, like, College Dropout, but then...
I really like Life of Pablo because the production's really cool. It's super... It's really interesting, and it's really, like, tailored. Like, the sound is, like really interesting. Yeah. I like the direction that he's going. I just think, like... Yo, we should talk it out, Kanye, if you hear this, man. Let's talk it out. Let's talk it out, dude.
I was actually pretty blown away first time I heard Real Friends. That song...
That's what I'm thinking of.
That, like, song is fucking good.
It's pretty.
Yeah, it's pretty. And, yeah. And lyrically, I feel like he's probably, like, on his most personal level, if you know what I mean. I don't know, especially with that song. With the $20,000 laptop. My cousin stole, you dirty motherfucker.
Exactly. No, that shit's great. And then also, but here's the thing. So, okay, Life of Pablo, it's like this, like, the line at the beginning where he's, like, about the, like, model bleaching her asshole.
Yeah.
It's, like, it's such a beautiful beat. It's, like, beautiful morning. It's, like, yo, this is the most beautiful thing of all time. Like, and it's just, like, yeah, dude, like, because Kanye's amazing, dude. And the music, he knows what's good, and, like, he's able to make amazing music. That's amazing music. It's, like, yo, it makes me feel like the sun's rising, birds are coming out, and then it's just, like, okay, think about this, like, model's asshole, though, and you're, like, about to fuck a model's asshole, and she just bleached it. And it's just, like, dude, like, damn it, it just totally, like, and actually when I was listening to the album, like, I'm saying, I think it's my favorite album of his, but I actually, a lot of the time, if I'm listening to that song, I just turn it down, just for those two lines, I'll just be like, bloop, and then I just, like, bring it back on. Like,
I know, cool. What you mean, yeah.
Because it's just, like, it's, like, it is too much for me, and it does kill my vibe.
Yeah. Bitch, don't kill my vibe, right?
Yeah.
No, it's crazy stuff, bro. Though. I wanted to get a bit into, your college phase of, like, when you were writing The Perfect Storm, and then, okay, like, because how did that transition into rap? Was that already planned, or, like, did something just hit you or, like, inspire you to be like, all right, I'm gonna actually do this shit?
You know, Kazu, just, like, I just want people to hear that, just, like, Kazu, thanks for fucking interviewing me, man.
I've been waiting to do this for a while, so, like, you know, like, as soon as I got the chance, I always had in my head, dude, I really gotta do Jonathan, because he's really hustling right now, so
I'm trying. Yeah, like, okay, yeah, let me answer that question. It's just like that, I've been up I've just been doing my own thing for a minute, hoping it's interesting to like somebody. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Okay, but so yeah, man, I still talk about. But okay, yeah, College Phase, Perfect Storm, and Almost Famous Mixtape. And for me, like, basically the thing is that I'm like super behind on the music that I'm trying to make.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, and I think it's true for like most artists, like the, like Almost Famous Mixtape, I put it out like last year pretty much.
Yeah.
And
did you want another one?
Oh, no, I'm still actually,
oh, you saw that? Okay, gotcha.
This actually, but, I put it out last year. But in reality, like I'd been thinking about doing that album for like a few years.
Right. Okay.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And the Perfect Storm, that actually was more like more in the moment where like I had written the songs like more recently, like
when
I was in college. But actually where that came from was that I was in school and like I went to Oberlin College in Ohio, and like
right.
For me, like it wasn't the best environment for me, and like you know, wasn't really a fan. But long story short, I wasn't able to study music. Like I thought it was a really good school for music, and I absorbed a lot there. I took some classes, but I had hoped to like major in music, and it didn't work out. And like so basically what happened was, this was 2012, and literally my college thesis draft for like to be a religion major, which I was, my college thesis draft was on like the day of the apocalypse, quote unquote, or like December 21st, like 2012.
Yeah.
And I was just like, and as I was kind of like being involved with school and stuff, I was like getting really frustrated, where I was like, wait a minute, like I'm 22, I want to do music, like that's what I want to do like for my life.
Yeah.
And like, you know, the clock, and I had been doing kind of from high school and earlier, I was like, I don't know how to put it, but like, I guess, what was it, 2010? I don't know, just sometime, I used to be playing music in the Valley at this spot called Cap, shout outs to Cap, Complete Actors Place.
Oh, okay.
Shout out to Cap.
It's like a theater place now.
Yeah, it was like a theater.
Okay.
And, but anyways, basically what I'm saying, there was a period like earlier than that, right after high school and like early college, where I was like playing a bunch of music and I was like doing it. Mm-hmm. And then like I kind of like didn't have time or something, and then I was just like getting really frustrated because I was like, damn, like I don't really have anything to show for myself, and like the people who are blowing up, like all these people blowing up are like 18 and 19, and I'm like, fuck, like it takes a bunch of years just to like get going anyways.
Yeah.
So I was like, damn, like I don't want it to be too late. So I basically just like dropped all my shit and just started recording that album. And also because it was the 2012 apocalypse, you know?
Yeah.
Like at that time, see, like, okay, now we're in 2017. Trump is about to be inaugurated president. And you know what? Like at that time, around 2012 and leading up to it, like there's a lot of motherfuckers out there who genuinely, so genuinely believed in some kind of like global event or something.
Oh yeah, that's a big deal. Yeah.
That would happen, and then now since then are just like, oh what? They're like, pfft. Like I don't know. I just think no one is like no one's talking about it because it's just past and whatever.
Yeah.
But like, I was kind of down, or I was down, but also kind of skeptical. I'm like, I don't think anything's gonna happen, but I really fucking hope something will, because you know, whatever cycles. You know, I don't know, historical cycles. Also, by the way, I had a friend who checked his sky maps or something on the day of the apocalypse.
Mm-hmm.
Shout out Alaska. He checked his phone and it did all line up. Like he saw like all the planets like line up. So it was like a you know, astronomical event.
Yeah.
But basically what I was thinking, like with the Perfect Storm album, is I'm just like, like to me it was like this really big idea that like didn't really fulfill like what I was trying, I don't know, I mean, it was whatever, but that I was trying to finish it for the apocalypse. I'm like, I'm gonna release it on the apocalypse, and I'm gonna put up, and I did do this though, because I had some friends in like Europe and I had some friends in like South America that I had met. I sent out posters of the allwallsshattered.com, which is now my label, but allwallsshattered.com like, that's just been my website or whatever, allaboutshattered.com. And I sent it around the world to as many places as I could get it, as far and wide. But it was really just, like, France, Germany, and, like, South America somewhere, like Argentina.
Yeah.
And I had people put it up and stuff that I was like, what if? What if? Because I was like, I bet nothing really happens on the apocalypse, but what if, you know, one lone, like, boy in a college room from dropping his album, like... And also, you know what? It's also this, that I'm like, every fucking hippie, no offense, every fucking hippie that really wanted to believe in the 2012 apocalypse and, like, wanted it to happen so bad, I'm like, well, did you try? Like, that not basically, true. Like, that's kind of where it was coming from for me, that I'm like, well, did you try? Like, so that's also why I think, like, I'm on some other level or, like, my own wavelength or something, is because I'm like, dog, I did it. I tried. Like, I straight up tried to, like, I don't know, put something out or create something that could be, like, some kind of globe. Like, to me, and so in that album, Perfect Storm, if anybody checks it out, like, to me, like, I put the ideas of what I thought, like, should be, like, the vibe or, like, the philosophy. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to think of better words, but, you know, like, for this new era, if it was gonna happen, like, damn, if every, like, and it, I know it's just, like, I know it's, like, not, like, it can't really, like, I don't know, it's just, like, a fun, like, music thing, but I'm just, like, yeah, man, if everybody could listen to this album, like, they would know what, like, our new age should, like, be about, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And, like, and then also that on some shit where, like, if people, and there's a few things like this, like, I'm legit, dog, and if other rappers want to fucking, like, criticize and, like, fuck with me, it's like, dude, like, anyways, it's just on some shit where it's like, dude, I put this album out on the fucking apocalypse, and it says that on iTunes, it is on iTunes, P.S., Jonathan, A Perfect Storm, if you search on iTunes.
Oh, okay.
It is there for purchase, like, it's still there.
Oh, okay.
I think.
Yeah, I mean, we could.
I think.
We could definitely look it up, but, so after you put the album out on Apocalypse, which is... I mean, you gotta have just a lot of courage just to be able to do that. I mean, like, on the day of the thesis they were supposed to turn, and then you just decided to just, like, drop out of school.
Yeah, it was goofy. Like, basically what happened was, like, I dropped the album, and then I just basically got suspended. Like, I tried to, like, finish my thesis really last minute, but I was, like, really focused on the album, because, like, that's where, like, my heart was, you know what I mean? And I just was like, oops. And, like, yeah, and so then I got suspended for, like, I guess a semester.
You get suspended for not turning in your thesis?
It had to do with past shit. I also, dog, like, in honesty, I had a bad college experience. I didn't like it. Fuck Oberlin College, like... No offense, I learned some things.
You're not the only one, dude, like, that hated the college experience. I mean, I enjoyed it, but I know from people that, like...
Where'd you go again?
I went to San Francisco State University.
Okay, word.
Yeah.
Did you find... Because honestly, like, dude, it was a whole other thing. It's overrated. Fucking liberal arts schools are overrated, I think. I don't know. It was just... I was really isolated. That was the worst thing. Like, I wish...
Well, that, I mean, at least you're pursued in your dream, like, while everybody else was, like... majoring in underwater basket weaving, you know? I mean,
no, but, like, that's actually not the truth, because, like, people were really good, like, honestly, Oberlin College, like, people were music majors and stuff. It's like, right. It's okay, because honestly, it's a put out there, like, when I played the Gathering of the Juggalos this year, that was the ultimate revenge for every bad experience that I had at Oberlin College. Oh, so, like, whatever, it's cool, like, I don't really give a fuck anymore. But, like, Gathering of the Juggalos, because it was also in Ohio.
Yeah.
Like, it was, like, not too far from there, and I kicked it, like, in around Cleveland with some friends.
How did you get, I was going to actually ask this question, too, but how did you get invited to play at Juggalos?
I hit them up, man. Shouts out to ICP and the Juggalo fam. Like, you know... Like, I hit them up. I tried the first year. I tried 2 years in a row, basically. And the first time, like, I didn't get it because I wasn't as together and I didn't have the Swagger Linda Berry video.
Mm-hmm.
Or, like, I had sent... The first year, I sent them, like, Sensitive to My Aura.
Yeah.
And then, which, like, I've kind of taken down, actually. I'm like, I don't know. If that's another thing. I'm like, I don't know if I should keep it or not.
Right.
But so they didn't... they didn't respond with that, and then like Swag, that's when, but like it, I think it matters. Like I'm saying, like I've been putting a lot of energy into just like making my whole appearance or whatever seem more professional and
of
shit.
Of course, yeah.
And
course.
Like, so I had put some time into it with that, and then like hit them up again with Swaggling to Barry, and like I really fucking put time into the email or something, and it was just like wanted it really bad, and mm-hmm. I feel like they sensed it. They fucked with it. Like people in the psychopathic offices, they saw it, you know, and like I just like it was a low key show, but I really fucking appreciate that they put me on and like had me out there, and like I had the, and that's the thing, I literally had one of the best times of my life, right. Period, like at the Gathering of the Juggalos. 2016, gathering number 17. Woo woo.
What was the? Because I mean, I've read quite a bit and like, you know, watched a lot of videos of like the Gathering of the Juggalos. Just out of curiosity, but like, I mean, because I hear, I'm actually pretty surprised. It's actually like a pretty legit hip hop event where it's not only just ICP related artists, but also yeah. like Coolio performs there. And
yeah.
Like,
okay. Yeah. Well, first I saw Slick Rick.
Yeah,
I was there. Who's a legend?
Yeah,
he's legendary, and he's like a like undeniable, and it shows. And to me, that was like real hip hop.
Yeah,
and that's what I'm trying to be on, to be honest. Where it's just like, you know, it doesn't. It's about like self, like making yourself better, self improvement and stuff. It's like Slick Rick's like 70 or 60 or some shit. He's pretty old, and he's buff as fuck. He's so buff. And he has so many chains. He's just... Anyways, it's just when you're there standing in front of him, I was like, wow, this is, like, the real thing. Like it's so real. He's so good. And the gathering in itself, it really is, like... it's a whole thing. Because when I first saw about the gathering when I was in college, and I didn't know about it. And I, like, growing up in Beverly Hills, Beverly High or whatever,
yeah.
I did not know about ICP or the Juggalos. And only when I was in college, somehow it came up on my radar, and I had no idea what it was, and I was like, wow, what the fuck is this? Like, what is this? But the thing, and they're like, yo, like it's like the only independent music festival of its kind, but the truth is, like, it fucking is, I think. I don't know about, I mean, I'm sure there's other independent festivals, maybe, but its scale is on point, dude. And here's how they have it set up that's so super smart, is that they have three different stages,
mm-hmm.
but the main stage is, like, Coachella-worthy.
Right.
Like, the main stage is, like, the nice shit. So, like, even though it's a smaller-ish, like, event or something... I mean, it's, like, it's sizable, but I'm just saying, like, even though they really put it on... Like, they have allocated, like, where they're putting the money, I felt like, in, like, really smart ways or something, where, like... So I was on like the pendulum stage, like the shitty stage, but you know what I mean? That stage is like whatever, normal, but you would think, I'm just saying like in my mind, I didn't know what to expect, and I was like impressed as fuck because their like main stage is like, they really like care. They, you know what I mean? Like it's the same as perform, like literally similar to performing at Coachella or like a major festival in terms of like the sound quality,
yeah,
like the size, the lighting, you know what I mean? So it's like, so at the same time, so like that's what I was impressed by, like they're giving their fans and the audience like the highest level, you
right.
feel me? Like
yeah.
And like that's super important. Shouts out ICP, shouts out Violent J.
Did you ever meet them?
I saw Violent, I met the dude Rob, aka Jump Steady, shout out. I met him at the festival. He was like the person that I've been communicating with.
Yeah.
And I saw Violent J after the festival's over, like with his makeup off.
Yeah.
Actually, but I like basically just said thank you really quick, but it was like kind of awkward, and honestly I was fucked up on a lot of shit, and
yeah.
I like it wasn't like a real interaction, and it's like I don't know, that's basically the gist, but I did see him, and I did get the chance to thank him, so you know, yeah, I really appreciate it, but it's like but I definitely like since then have been like, not but just like since going to the gathering and the whole thing, like I've been like inspired by them, and mostly on just like they hold it down, like just on being like a really original artist that like doesn't really have a category, but like they've still managed to like create a whole culture for themselves.
Right. Yeah. I've seen like a good amount of interviews with ICP, and they sound like really cool guys. And it sucks because I feel like people in general gives Juggalos a bad name, or like just because what is it? I read that like they were like classified as like gang from like FBI and, or some shit.
Yeah,
like
do you know about the whole thing? They're gonna do a Juggalo march on Washington.
Yeah, I heard about that too.
You know what? If anybody from Psychopathic hears this, I'm down to play. You know, I feel like I probably need some time to keep like developing my shit before I'm like back or something. Maybe I mean I'll probably hit him up again, but like I want to get my shit going. But I'm just saying, the Juggalo march on Washington, like it's like a serious thing. It's a serious thing for them.
Oh yeah, it's a big deal, because I mean, what if there's like a person, like a businessman or lawyer, for example, who grew up listening to ICP and has like a hatchet tattoo, and all of a sudden, you know, he gets fired from his job for being a part of that in the past. You know, exactly. Like I just feel like that's very unfair, and you know, it's not cool at all. You know?
No, so, exactly. Yeah. And also like, I don't know. Yeah, I'm just really curious because, you know, we got Donald Trump coming in as president, and it just so happens that that's like, you know, will have just started, and now they want to do their Juggalo march. And I just think it's going to be interesting because like the Juggalos are going to bring so much flavor to Washington, and I don't think Washington is ready for that flavor, dude.
It's going to splash the whole place with like Faygo or some shit like that. You know?
Yeah. Who knows? I'm actually really excited. I guess basically what I'm saying is like, I don't know if you've seen, or if anybody's seen the ICP video where they're like going through the suburbs and they have like their whole like clown, like chaotic, like clown cars and shit like that. Do you know what I'm talking about?
No,
they're like kind of
so,
like going through the suburbs, and they're kind of fucking shit up, and like that's what I imagine that the march might be like, but in this way that's just like, it's like honestly in this way where I'm like, what I'm trying to say is that it's what our country needs, because it's like it's like taking like the most freaky down fucking people and like having them just like throw a big freaky march in Washington, like right at the time that shit is as most sterile, you know, as like possible and shit. Like, so I think that's fucking awesome, and I fucking have like a lot of respect for anybody that goes out to the Juggalo march.
Yeah. What was the this is based on the gathering of the Juggalos festival that you played at, but because I hear it's fucking wild, but what's the craziest thing that you've seen there? I mean, I don't know if that's kind of a vague question in a sense, but like, I don't know, just kind of wondering based on your experience, like what are some shit that you saw there that was like, wow.
I'll just be honest, Kazu.
Yeah.
Because I might not have the chance to say this many places.
Yeah, go for it.
It was at the moment that my face was like, I was like face full into like a pair of tits. Okay, and like my good friend that I'd come with was like that, come with to the gathering. Anyways, face full of tits, and then my good friend was like whipping my ass with a fucking flogger. Okay, like at the same time,
flogger.
You know what I mean? Like essentially like a sex toy.
Oh, okay, yeah.
You mean like a whip?
Yeah, the whip. Yeah, okay.
And it was at that moment, face full of tits, getting flogged, that I was like, yo, I did the fucking gathering of the Juggalos. Like, that's what I have to say. Because it wasn't really about, I would say it wasn't about, like, seeing some shit, like, some crazy shit. It was just more, like, the experience.
Oh, yeah, of course.
And,
yeah.
Like, that was the craziest shit that basically happened to me. But, like, other people have even crazier stories. And I will say that, and I, you know what, I mean, we should, you know, we can talk about other shit. But, like, people, anyways, if you think about going to the gathering, one, you should go. Two, I felt like, you know, the gathering was a place where people's Juggalo, like dedication to being a Juggalo was, like, rewarded. You know what I mean?
Right.
Because, like, the dude who was in our camp who, you know, I met cool-ass people. Like, I met a lot of really cool people. Shout out to Mark and Leona, if you're listening, and Tyler. The dude who was camping with us who was like fucking diehard Juggalo from Oregon, like, you know, like, got, he just, he basically just got with some dope chick and shit, like, he got, he macked, like, really hard, I guess is what I'm trying to say.
No, I see, okay.
You know what I mean? Like, people's Juggalo dedication was rewarded, and I was bearing witness, you know?
That's cool.
To that. Because yeah. Because honestly, I'm not going to, like, front, like, I'm a Juggalo, you know, now, but I'm only scratching the surface of like the ICP catalog and shit like that, and like the full knowledge, you know what I mean?
The whole experience of it, yeah. I wanted to get into another subject, which is Swagalinda Berry. And because the first time I saw it, for some reason, I think it was on World Star Hip Hop, and it has millions of views, and did you just release that and all of a sudden it got just a lot of attention, and did it get to that much, or like did you like, I was just kind of shocked the first time I saw it, because usually like when new videos come out on World Star Hip Hop, it does get a lot of views, but especially as like unsigned artists as you are, like, you know, it's kind of coming out like this.
It's true. Like, I mean, I wonder. I haven't really compared it to like that many other videos on there. So like, I got 1.3 million views on WorldStar.
That's crazy.
But it doesn't carry over to YouTube, you know, which is unfortunate. So it's crazy though. So I don't know. So I just know I'm out there. Like, okay, you know, Kazu. This is the in this like honest, straightforward interview.
Uh-huh.
Like, I'll be honest with you. Like, I paid for it to be like sponsored.
Okay.
And, like, beyond World Star.
Okay.
You know.
Mm-hmm.
Cause I was kind of asking around. I mean, whatever. That's just like I fuck with World Star, but I got this video done. By Ted Cadillac, who has shot some stuff for Wiz Khalifa, and he's also like Juicy J's, like he does a lot of video for Juicy J's.
Oh wow.
J's.
Okay.
Juicy J, and basically like yeah, I just wanted to come hard with it. I mean, honestly, like my approach to music in terms of like the promotion and the marketing and stuff, like I'm trying to refine that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And was basically just like, but also I've kind of been on a fuck it, like, and that's whatever, Kanye let me down and stuff like that. It's like, rap game, like, you may not acknowledge me, you may not see me, but, like, I see you, and this is my fucking response to it. And I think that, like, why not? Like, I could be, I don't know, like, I can be up there and whatnot. But anyways, I wanted to put it out on World Star. It was kind of like a test to like see what that like is, and what that, you know, what, just see what the response would be.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And whatnot. And it was kind of like a mix of like positive and negative and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, so that's the explanation, is like I put it up there,
mm-hmm.
type of thing,
right? Yeah.
And that's how World Star do, but it's impressive, like that's how they do business, you know what I mean? And thank you, and also thanks to World Star for like for putting me on, though I don't know if they just do anything. I'm just trying to like reach as many people as possible.
Yeah,
like that's a huge, you know, that's a huge thing, and I
it's an accomplishment though, in a sense, because I mean, I feel like your video was pretty unique to the level where it completely differentiated from like possibly like a lot of the videos out there, you know. So I mean, I don't know, I dig the song a lot.
Yeah, thanks, man. Yeah, thanks, man. And then also like I mean, with my music, like part of it that I'm trying to do is that I'm trying to say like deal with me or something, like. That, I guess what I'm trying to say is like kind of with the thing, like what I was saying about like folk musicians, and like there's like some slight tension sometimes, but it never gets like spoken about, let's say hypothetically.
Yeah.
It's just on some shit, like I'm trying to be this like voice, I'm trying to bring up some shit from all over the place that just doesn't get talked about.
Right.
Like that's what I would like to do if mm-hmm. possible, like with my music, if God, we'll see what's up, but like, you know, like bring up shit that isn't talked about, that's like, and so like, for me to be like putting Swaggle to bear on World Star, to have me being like this like crazy white dude basically that's just like, I don't know, like a little bit too like off his rocker or something like that, kind of like cackling like on his fucking throne or some shit that like he created and is just like, I don't know how to put it, but like the type of also, dude, like honestly, the fact that like I more or less came from Beverly Hills, mm-hmm. type of thing, I feel like is a factor that I'm just trying to like embrace and like incorporate into my music.
I hear that, yeah.
And honestly, on some shit where it's just like people don't know like the what it really is, or like I don't know, like just like the whole world is like looking at like,
well, they have a notion
LA culture and like the Kardashians, yeah. or something, and like thinking that they know like, oh, okay, like wealth in Beverly Hills is like this one thing or something, but like it's not. And I don't know, it's just some kind of thing that basically, even if I would, like if I was a folk musician, yeah. if I was like a more successful like songwriter, I just feel like that shit would like come back to me anyways. And then instead, like with hip-hop and like coming into rap music, I'm just kind of like more just trying to be like, well, trying to be upfront with it, like fuck it, like yeah, like let's go, like this is who I am. And so like by putting it on World Star or whatever, like I'm okay, like I feel like it's, yeah, like the music and the videos and the art and stuff that I'm making, I think is like confrontational,
mm-hmm.
I think it is confrontational, and that I feel like so much, you know, that so much of the rap shit and like what is popular is like so much on a distraction level, you know what I mean, and so I guess with my music, what I want to do, and we'll see what's up, but like, I mean, yeah, anyways, what I want to do is like come in there and just be like, no, like be like, you don't want to look at this, but like look at this, and it's like me. And like I'm trying to bring it in like hopefully like an entertaining way, but I don't know exactly how people will take it,
yeah.
And I also know, like, I mean, like we'll see what's up, but like Donald Trump, our elected president, he's gonna be inaugurated, and like I'm a little worried that, but I don't know, it's like I want to bring myself to like the forefront of like culture or something, like I'm trying to do my hardest or whatever, I'm like working out here to like, you know, push myself out there, have people know about me and whatever,
yeah.
although just put out, like I'm on a slow grind where I'm like, I will be doing this for a long time, so I'm like, you know, World Star, I don't know if I will or won't be on World Star again, but it's like just being out there for a million people to have just seen it at some point in time, like then maybe later, even years later, when I'm like coming out with some other shit, like,
yeah,
they, who knows, it still might, they still might remember or something, it still might, it will have, you know, they will have seen it, it could be somewhere there in their head or whatever,
yeah, yeah.
But like I guess what I'm trying to say is like, I'm like, damn, it's not, it's, it seems like it's shitty timing in terms of like, I want to come out with this like hardcore rap music that's like about, but anyways, I'm gonna do it anyways, I'm just saying like if I was to like become more successful, you know, over time or in the next some years, it's like will be when Trump is president,
yeah.
And it's like just kind of, I don't know, like I feel like damn, it might be like a super annoying combo,
yeah. What was the how did you come up with the name J-Dub?
J-Dub is because I'm Jonathan Weiss, and it actually was from like young, I don't know, back in like early high school, I don't know, and I was like, some people from camp, from summer camp, shouts out, yeah, some people from summer camp would call me J-Dub. It's like Jonathan Weiss, Jay Weiss. It'd be like, yo, Jay Weiss. And it's like, J Dub. It's like, JW. So it's like, yo, JW. Jonathan Weiss. Yo, JW. J Dub. You know? And, yeah. Also, like, I don't know. I just wanted to keep, my normal name. Because I wanted it to, like, not be, like, a character. or something like that. Like, you have, like, rats like Angel Hayes, or, like, that's an example. But I don't know, just, like, rappers who are, like, anyway, I just wanted to keep my own name. Like, I'm Jonathan Weiss, but, like, I feel like Jonathan Weiss is not super catchy. I mean, we'll see, but I don't know, something about J-Dub, and then just, like, whatever, keeping it, like, a little bit more hip-hop, but it's kind of bad. Like, J-Dub's, like, not that cool of a name at the same time, but, like, I don't know, it just works. Somehow it works. It works. It makes sense to me, like, okay, I want to be Jonathan, a.k.a. J-Dub, because, yeah, I feel like it could just cover all the ground of the shit I'm trying to do. I don't want to just be J-Dub. I don't want to be, like, Jonathan. I'm saying Perfect Storm, I think it's on iTunes as Jonathan.
Right,
like,
yeah.
Just Jonathan.
That's what I know. Yeah.
But, like, that is so... It just gets washed away in, like, a sea of, like, shit. And there's also a million J-Dubs, too. There's also a lot of different J-Dubs.
Because, like, the first impression that I had about J-Dub was, like, kind of like a reggae artist, in a sense.
Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like, well, no, there is a reggae artist named J-Dub.
Oh, okay.
Do you know about that? I saw...
From the name Dub, it was kind of reggae-ish, right. But go on, though, yeah.
There's a artist named J-Dub, I think maybe J-Dubs, who was playing at Reggae on the Mountain. Okay, I saw that. I see you, dog. I saw that. He was, like, so I was like, okay, he's playing, like, he's kind of, like, a lower-down name on, like, Reggae on the Mountain, which is, like, a pretty big reggae festival in, like, California.
Yeah.
And then I'm like, all right, well, I'm playing the Gathering of the Juggalos. Like, I'm on there, you know what I mean? And I kind of, like, I've kind of been through some different stuff with the name. Like, I kind of changed it, blah, blah, blah. Like, I was going to just be Jonathan Weiss for a minute, but now I'm back to J-Dub because... I just think it's catchier. And Jonathan, a.k.a. J-Dub, something about it, that's what I want to see. That's what I want to see on lineups and stuff like that. Like, oh, yeah. I could just see, like, I'm like, all right, who's playing? Jonathan, a.k.a. J-Dub, da-da-da, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know. That's what I want it to be.
It fits, in a sense, yeah.
Word. I'm feeling it, you know? Like, yeah.
I wanted to ask about the... Was there, like, a girl in particular that was inspired to... make Swaggle
Linda Berry.
Yeah.
Yo, Swaggle Linda Berry. Do people know, hey, shout out, like, do people know who Linda Berry is and the whole thing? Like, do you know?
She's a comic book artist.
She was friends with Matt Groening, who did The Simpsons in college, and she has her own stuff. But basically, like Swaggle Linda Berry, not really, like, a certain person, like, no, not really, is more like an imaginary person.
Yeah.
That's, like, I was kind of, like, getting out my, like, angst and my anger about, like, shit in college, where I was, like, a lot of, like, art girls and, like, art school girls and stuff who were, like, not giving me the time of day type of shit.
Yeah.
And just on some stuff where it's, like, and actually that song also was really inspired by Death Grips.
Oh, yeah.
To be honest. Yeah. Where it's, like, where this, like, you know, Death Grips has, like, crazy, like, industrial sound, and then the dude's just like, yeah, rah, rah, like, he's just, like, going all crazy.
Yeah, I'm serious.
But, like, yeah. To me, like, the inner message of it, though, like, some, not all of it, but the inner message of some of it is, like, ah, wanna, bitch, wanna, swagger, wanna, berry, like, yeah. Where they're just, like, it's all, because also, you know what, also in school, in this one class, like, yo, hey, people, if you're hearing this comment, and let me know what you think about this, but, like, there was this class about surrealism where they're basically saying, like, all this surrealist art, like, Andre Breton and stuff. So basically, certain artists are just trying to get pussy.
Yeah.
Like, basically. And, like, you know, like, musicians and stuff like that, it's, like, a component of it is, like...
Some musicians starts off that way. It's, like, I want to get girls and they start playing guitars. And,
yeah, yeah, yeah. And, like, that's, like, a part of it. So I guess I kind of was, like... That was kind of on my mind at the time that, like, is it all, like... Not all, but, like, you know what I mean? Like, will people see me doing music stuff and like, the root of it that I subconscious, I don't even realize, but it's all just to, like, get girls or something?
Uh-huh.
And that basically, like, I don't know. It's just something about Death Grips. Like, that's what I'm saying. Oh, yeah. Also, like, the Kanye thing and, like, I just like to imagine certain shit that, like, might not exist. So, like, with the Almost Famous album, I was thinking, like, Rick Rubin... Like, the producer, right? Like, Rick Rubin?
I think you said some line about Rick Rubin.
Oh, yeah, I was like, fuck Rick Rubin. Come at me, bro.
Yeah, that's it.
Come at me, bro. But just on some shit where it's like, what if Rick Rubin's an amazing producer. He's produced, like, these legendary albums, Adele, Chili Peppers, like, just like the list goes on, whatever. But like, but where's the Rick Rubin album? You know, what if Rick Rubin like made the Rick Rubin album and he's just like, yo, sit down, rappers, like, cause his Wikipedia, like his accomplishments are like way more. His as a producer, his accomplishments surpass like all of these hip hop people and like pretty much anybody low key like in the game. But he's an amazing at music.
Yeah.
So where's the fucking Rick Rubin album? And like that was like an inspiration for what I was doing. Like I'm gonna make it. I'm gonna, you know what I mean? Like I want to be active in the music world.
Yeah.
And etc. for a long time. But I just want to like always have my own thing where I'm coming out with my own shit.
Yeah.
And long story short, Swagalinda Berry, I'm saying that's like another thing with Death Grips. I'm like, what if Death Grips made a song like instead of being on their crazy like psycho shit, they were just like, they're like, okay, this is what it's really about. I'm trying to fuck an artistic woman tonight. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I'm trying, like they're just like, I'm trying to like bang, because they talk about banging and stuff, but like what. And then also I was trying to be like, trying to because honestly, Kazu, like honestly, from like certain time when we were kids in like high school or some shit, there's kind of this culture that's emerged that's like kind of like Michael Cera culture or something like that, where it's like the like shy, like introspective kind of dudes and stuff,
indie rock kids,
yeah, like indie kind of rock kids or something. Like, not like Michael Cera's cool, shout out, but like I'm just saying, but I'm just saying like that type of dude or something, where like, and that's basically when I was at Oberlin College. That's a lot of who was like around, you know, or like kind of these like introspective, like super quiet and like sensitive guys, you know. But like, you know, so that was a big inspiration with Swagalinda Berry, was to like speak, like, I don't know, it's, that's why I think it's, it works as a song, and people super fuck with it actually. And like, I always have good, like, it's, it bangs. And also shout out to Willie S. Calvini for doing the beat, because it bangs and people like recognize.
I didn't even know that he made beats. That surprised me. Like, as soon as he was put it on there,
He's out there. He's got all kinds of shit. And but anyway, so like the kind of like introspective like indie dude. It's like, I'm like, yo, this is like, I'm J-Dub. Let me be your voice box. Like, you know what I mean? Like, you don't, like, I mean, like, as if, like, someone's listening to it and they're just like, yo, I just didn't know how to have the words to, like, say that, you know? But, like, J-Dub, like, you really, like, spoke for me in that situation. And just, like, you know? And then also, like, I also kind of feel like with doing Linda Berry, which also I wonder if she's ever heard it. I did actually reach out to her at some point too. Like,
oh wow, you reach out to a lot of people.
Well, no, but she didn't get back to me. Or like, I tried to just be like, hey, I made this song about you. Like, I waited for a long time and I was like, felt nervous, but I like hit her up and she didn't hit me back or anything. So
no, I see.
Whatever, but just on some stuff where it's like, I just feel like that person, yo, Linda Berry encapsulates a lot of like what the, I don't know, certain girls I knew in college like would be like about that kind of thing, like the chill, like chill introspective like comic stuff. And then like, cause yeah, and that like whatever, it's like just a representation of like male angst or something, like they're trying to just be the inner voice, you know, like just like as it, like I don't know how to put it, like, but yeah, so it's just like a mix of like trying to kind of like get back at the people, at people who would like be that person, because I feel like I'm kind of making fun of like stereotypical like art chicks or something, because like there's a lot of them out there, and don't be one of them, you know. And then trying to be like these dudes who are like really shy, and maybe they're folk musicians, or maybe they're like tinkle with their synths or some shit, but like inside they have this raging fire that they don't know how to express, and I'm like, dog, I know the feeling, man, like let me fucking like let it out and unleash it on the world.
Yeah, I have a few more questions before I want to wrap this up, but for all my interviews I like asking this question, but what's the best live show you've ever seen?
Whoa.
It doesn't matter whether, I mean, you could even, I even tell people, it could even be a DIY show or even a venue, right. Even a venue show too. And
no, that's a good question. That's a really good question. I want to like think of something that's super legit.
You could even do venue show and DIY show.
Best live show that I've ever been to. Can I like just drop a few or something?
That's fine. Yeah, I mean, it could even be something that you've seen and you're just like, holy shit, you know. So it doesn't. I'm right. When I say best, it's kind of maybe a bit too over exaggerated because like best is kind of a, it's a strong word.
I just so. That's a really good question though, because like so many, like I think music is kind of separated from like the live experience right now, and like
no, it's true. It's true.
Yeah. Some great best live shows. Honestly, like this past year, I saw Guar at the Gathering of the Juggalos.
Guar was there?
Yeah.
Wow.
That shit was actually super fucking crazy. that was definitely amazing. Also, like, I feel like I'm gonna forget actual things. I really love King Khan and the Shrines.
Yeah.
Okay. And like they're one of my favorite bands to see live.
Okay.
They've been really good. I saw Japanther in high school at like the house called Women, like at some DIY.
Oh wow!
But that was like tight because I don't know what happened with Japanther. Like that was just like some really real like dope fucking backyard shit that was tight. Like that was like super fun.
It's like a house show.
Like, yeah, it was like a house show.
That's always the best, dude. Yeah.
So I feel cool that like that's just like a noteworthy show. And then I'm trying to think like ever. I saw James Blake this year. He was fucking amazing.
Yeah. Oh, did you? Was that at the Palladium?
Yeah.
Ah, fuck, I missed it. Vince Staples opened, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
How was he?
Super cool.
He was good too.
Vince Staples is super cool. Yeah.
Yeah.
But I want to bring like when I'm as I'm doing rap and stuff like that, I want to bring more of like a performance element out of it.
Of course.
Because I just feel like rappers like Vince Staples' music is some of my favorite right now, and like I fucked heavily with Vince Staples, and I like want to fucking collaborate with him.
He's fucking smart as hell.
Like, yeah, exactly. He's the man.
He's in Long Beach too. So
he's funny. He's like, funny. Yeah. I just love the whole all shit. But to me, like, you know, he just got up there and like did his thing, you know what I mean? But like, I don't know, I have a difference or something between like rap shows and like rap music.
Oh, yeah.
Because I always want there to be like more of a show, and it's just a person like standing there like
what,
rhyming.
What do you think about, because like I see that in a lot of those rappers where they would play a backtrack where there's already vocal in it, and then they'll just go ahead and just sing over that, you know.
Yeah.
And then I just feel like that's kind of like a karaoke but without the karaoke machine kind of a deal, and
yeah, man,
it's a little bit weird to me. I'm not
it
sure
it is weird, and that's the whole thing. Like, that's only my opinion because it's satisfactory for a lot of people.
Oh, yeah.
But I think it's become also, wait, with live shows, just to put it out there, Rothbury 2009, fucking legendary. What was that? Yo, just Rothbury 2009 Legendary. It was a festival that became Electric Forest before it was Electric Forest, and that was, like, the best concert I've ever been to. But that was a whole day of festival, so it wasn't, like, one person in particular, but, like,
it's the experience that counts.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But I saw Willie Nelson, Bob Dylan, Girl Talk play Mastercraft. It was cool.
That's a pretty humongous lineup, too.
That's a highlight also of my life. And the Juggalos is, like, next after that. But, like, rapping shows versus, like, recorded music, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like, this is just my opinion, because I'm not trying to, like, say that everybody should think this way, but, like, because came up listening to, like, more, like, less rap music and more, like, rock and experimental shit, or like more out there shit and more band like stuff, basically.
Yeah, same here.
Like, I really appreciate like the live show and the live experience of musicians like vibing off each other.
Exactly.
And like,
yeah,
feeling off each other. And if you're a rapper and you're just playing off your recorded track, like, it's set in stone basically what's gonna happen, more or less. So for me, that's been like less interesting when I see people live, But then the difference is that a lot of the rap music is, like, better in, like, personal space.
Yeah.
Like, in principle, in your car. Like, you listen, like, in your own, on your own time when you're listening to it, like, it's better than other music. It's, like, bumps harder and, like, fucking, like, feel yourself more, like, listening to some rap music than listening to more, like, I mean, it depends, but some rock music, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I
but,
mean, it's, yeah. I think it's also, like, the energy that the performer delivers too, because for example, my girlfriend and I were a really big fan of Schoolboy Q, and and we've seen him twice, and every time he plays a show, he fucking kills it. Like, and it's, I think it's all about the fact that we're at one. I mean, there are backtrack only for like the chorus, but then like, but besides that, though, like he is like really hamming it through, and I'm really impressed that he's able to do that. You know, just like. I mean, shouts out to
no, I feel TD, you. I've also I've noticed that also where like it just it actually just depends on like the artist and the rapper, and that's actually what's really interesting to me is that
it
like,
is, yeah.
Some people can create the vibe and then some people like it's less there. I haven't seen Schoolboy Q live, but now I feel like I should.
It's a must, yeah.
Yeah, and then also, but the person that I've seen live that I felt like really brought the vibe was Chief Keef, actually.
Oh, really?
Yeah, like, because I've been, I don't want to talk about rappers who, like, didn't bring it because I don't want to talk shit, but, like, I've, yeah, like, and the, and I went to a Chief Keef show at the, Observatory in Santa Ana.
Oh, the OC one, yeah.
And that's an example of, like, where someone was just doing it over the pre-recorded track. Like, they basically just played a lot of his music, you
yeah,
know what
yeah,
I mean?
Yeah.
And he was, like, rapping over it, but it was more just, like, a posse, like, just everybody, all his homies up on stage and just, like...
No, it's they're all on their phone and stuff,
whatever.
Taking pictures and stuff.
Yeah, I mean, not really, but it was just, like, they're just kind of, you know, bouncing around and shit, but, like, I just felt like, I super felt the vibe or something, like, you know, and, it wasn't, I don't know, it wasn't boring, it was tight. I don't know, and so, like, that's, like, I want, one, I mean, I want to be one of those rappers that brings that vibe, but definitely, like, as time goes on, I want to have more of a live band and stuff. And also rappers, like, rappers with a live band fucking, like, always fucking bring it down.
Oh, yeah.
Like, you know what I mean? Always, like, fucking...
I think Kendrick does that. Like, he has, like, a live band with him and stuff.
Word.
Too.
I don't know if... I know he does... He did a tour with it. I don't know if it's all the time. Probably, yeah, though. Actually, I saw a video of him doing it live with that. I saw Kendrick one time, but not with the band.
Oh, you seen him before?
Yeah.
Damn,
yeah,
it's tight.
Like, it's tight. And I was just like, he's good. I was like, is he really this good? And then I saw him live, like, yeah. Like, he's that good for sure. Like, he's got it off the charts.
Speaking of which, he is working with Rick Rubin too, so I mean,
exactly,
yeah.
Yo, Rick Rubin, I'm coming for you, man. Like, watch. No, I don't know, hopefully we could kick it maybe, but you know, it's just on some, like, when I said like fuck Rick Rubin in that song, one, I'm just like, I wonder if anybody's ever said that ever, so just like, let's throw that out there,
right?
But also, it's on some, like, I was basically trying to criticize, like, kind of, like, spiritual people and, like, Zen people who are just, like, super zened out and are just, like, always, like, in touch with the frequency.
Yeah.
But it's, like, we need those people, in my opinion, like, we need those people to act. And, like, where the fuck are you? Like, I'm just saying, like, people who are, like, I mean, Rick Rubin's tight, but, like, at this point, he's done so much. I was just more like on that song, that was like my political song or something. Put this shit on Upworthy. That's the song, but like, that's the political song. But basically what I was trying to say with that is just like, where, like, people who have been around for a long time and are very like in touch and like spiritual.
Yeah.
I'm trying to say like, where the fuck have you been? Like, why are you letting the world, like why am I raised in this world that's already so fucked? Like,
right.
I came into this world, like, so fucked, and, like, you know, the world has just, you know, just been fucked, and it's, like, you know, it's just more out of frustration. Like, I was just trying to come at that super out of frustration, like, 'cause I don't really hear that. I don't really hear that in music, so I was trying to fill in that gap, like, why, where these people been, like the people who are all pseudo spiritual and
mm-hmm.
have like been that for years and decades and stuff like that, and like, you know, shit is like dire right now, and like, where have you been? Like, why are you? And just more trying to speak for like future kids or some of your generations that might feel that way, where it's right. like it's yeah, like yeah. where, and then like I want to try to be a person that's like, if possible, like, you know, trying to like make that change or something like that, because like it's only, I mean, yeah, it's only getting worse, but it's just like, where, like, you come up in the world and you're just like, wow, it's so fucked up, but there's so many people who testify to like wanting to change it and like being like, hey, I'm like a source of truth and goodness. And it's like, well, fucking, like, we need things to happen. Like, where's the real change, you know? So that's where that was coming from.
I see. Man, that's crazy, dude. Well, I just want to say thank you so much for, like, participating and, like, you know, talking about all this all this stuff. Because, yeah. I learned so much more about you. But before we end the show, I was wondering, I wanted to play one of your track, and I want you to pick it for the audience to listen to.
Okay.
Yeah. What would you select?
Okay, so I want the people to hear Kanye Let Me Down.
Kanye Let Me Down? All right, we'll go with that then. All right, well, I just want to say thank you once again, and, you know, good luck with everything that you're going to come up with. So new music is coming soon too, you say?
I'm going to drop an EP this year. I'm mostly working on videos.
Okay.
To be honest, I've been working with Ben Crossman, who is the art director of DeAntWord.
What? Really?
That's crazy. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
DeAntWord's tight, dude.
Yeah, DeAntWord is tight. I'm only homies with Ben, just to say, but, like, Ben's a dude. Shout out to Ben Crossman. Anyways, but okay, in terms of new stuff, I'm gonna, like, for sure drop an EP this year. I'm working on the next album, but, like, that's, like, more of a ways away. So I'm more, like, working on videos to come out this year for sure. EP 100%, and then like the album, like I want to try to finish it by the end of the year, but like it's gonna take a bit.
Gotcha. Well, thank you so much for everything, man.
Oh yeah, no problem. Thank you so much, dude, for like hitting me up.
No problem, dude. Thanks.
Life can be so frustrating sometimes when you know that you're a fucking genius and you try to reach out to somebody to like get you to where you want to go, you know. Maybe you're trying to make a shoe. Maybe you're trying to get people to recognize that you're the future of multimedia and they won't fucking hear you out. It's so frustrating. Man, I know I'm just a kid from Beverly Hills, but I still got dreams. Kanye let me down. Him wearing the crown straight out of Chi-Town, waiting for an angel from heaven to fly down and announce him the leader of the new world theater. Whole globe's the stage and he's all the rage and angry tweeter, but not much of an email reader. He's couldn't take the time to hit reply, so I looked at the sky and asked rap god why. Why you never believed in me? Why couldn't you see the person that could be in me? To the dude who murders verse, curse and curse, survive a god, but still commercial, controversial, cause his jeans were skinny. I remember that one day when I saw the news. I think maybe that I had seen it on the Pitchfork News. You tweeted that you were taking applications for Donda. Then my mouth salivated and my mind did wander. It would feel so special sitting next to Kanye. You're my every morning cup of espresso. A long email I proceeded to send. Did you not read it or did you just go delete it instead? How could I actually think you'd let me into your factory? Too busy shaking your head off camera, the Kardashians, to get back to me. Moving way past validation to a land of self-infatuation. Kanye let me down. Him wearing the crown straight out of Chi-Town, waiting for an angel from heaven to fly down and announce him the leader of the new world theater. Whole globe's the stage and he's all the rage, an angry tweeter, but not much of an email reader. Jesus couldn't take the time to hit reply, so I looked at the sky and asked rap god why. We're just trying to do our thing, comparing A and J to be like Google to Bing. But when I saw you with your mask and your dancers, I thought you might have the answer. Yeah, you're so fly, dog, I could be your traitor. I swear, homie, I'll never betray you. Then the story would never end. Ayo, when you get back to me, let the story begin. Only child of a strong teacher, mom, too. And boy, you know I like croissants, too. Also a man of the Renaissance, got a box of pastries from La Provence for your whole crew. This ain't real, recognize real. This ain't do what you feel. This ain't no dream, if you will it, you ain't giving up the crown, so I had to go and steal it. Hold up, Kanye let me down. I let me down? Why did you let me down, yay? Why did you let me down, Kanye let me down. Why did you let me down? Why did you let me down, yay? Why did you let me down, I really thought I liked you. Now I'm leaking shit from last year's sessions just to spite you. Yeah, that's right, I got the insider shit. Leaking your shit right now, here it goes.
Right, this is Ziggy C. Lay from ZBC Radio. I spent every single millisecond of my being wondering what's Kanye gonna do next. Well, now it's right here in front of us. It's Kanye West with none other than Sir Paul McCartney. Let's hear the track, and it's gonna roll now.
Oi, yeah, what? I'm Paul McCartney, please don't start with me. Sometimes I can't remember where I put me car keys. But still, I'm on the mark for real, like Mark would do play golf, my hard to do it for the thrill.
Ever walked across streets and beefed with John Lennon? Ever smoked fat spliffs in cars with Bob Dylan? No, I don't think you have, mate, cause the title of a living legend, that's not really up for grabs, mate.
Average day, enjoy me tea and bickies in a rocker stadium and get a backstage quickie. Rest of the night is a blur, it's just a bunch of faceless fuck blokes calling me sir. I beg your pardon, but all the nanas in the front want me inside of their octopus's garden. When I'm hardened, that's right, I'll get drunk, wear helmets, ride horses on my fucking night. Other rappers, Ringo, that's extraneous, spitting with Yeezus, second coming to Beatlemania.
Damn, McCartney's got bars. Nobody knows, because it's never been caught on film before, what that man can do. But anyways, I'm going to take it back to Kanye. I just got a few more things I want to say to the musical genius of our time, so here we go.
You think there's nothing brighter or sharper than you, no Excalibur. Think these other rappers is wacker than your caliber. Well, watch your throne closer, cause I'm taking dumps on it. Keep winning the life, wonder when you're coming, interrupt on it. Oh, they think you're so obnoxious, but they can't see the battlefield, it's so subconscious. Shout out to the ghost of Tupac that haunt this, and holler at your boy for a collab if you want this. We all miss the A, inspirated by orthodontists. At least you keep in peace in the kingdom of hip hop. You keep the airwaves fresh, yeah, you know how it go. You make them question and the revolution grow. But first you gotta check your mom, see you're making her proud, and then go catch up with your cousins at your auntie's house. Hey, when you gonna come by, man, for memorable times? I bet we vibe a real hard player, and I ain't lying. We could bake lots of cookies, make dioramas, chill in the Bahamas in our matching pajamas. But deep in my heart, I know it won't be the reality, cause when it comes down to it, yeah, you don't value me. You know Messiah this way higher than me, he's just the man I'm fucking tired of aspiring to be. Cause when that voice say, what would Ye do? That's when Jay do some stupid shit that's too unstable, then make them hate you, and then you go and isolate. But maybe that's the price of fate. If you exacerbate some shit, then them calling you an ass is accurate. And I know what don't kill me could make me stronger, but if I didn't say that shit, that last relationship would've lasted longer. Oh, why did I say that shit? Oh, why did I say that shit? I kinda said that shit. Oh, why did I say that shit? Ooh, I said that shit. Why did I say that shit? Ooh, I said that shit. I shouldn't have said that shit, but I said some shit. Ooh, Kanye. Ooh, Kanye. Ooh. Anyways, so I'ma go and end this debate and say fuck you, Ye. I would rather be J-Dub. Fuck you, Ye. I think I'd rather be J-Dub. Ay, yo, peace, man, but know that it's all love. Kanye let me down, but I'm still living though. Twisted Fantasy, it's like a good album, but like, perfect is a really strong word. I don't know, man. I think you just convinced the internet of some shit, which is so hard to do. That's impossible. Who could just convince the internet of something? The people have very strong fucking moral compasses with that shit. No one falls for bullshit on the internet, that's for sure. So I don't know how you managed to pull that off, but anyway, you know, hats off to you. Yeah, good for you, man. You're doing all right.
This interview. I'm really looking forward to what Jonathan's going to do next.
Don't forget to subscribe to my channel and like this video, because more album reviews and podcast episodes will be coming. My name is Kazu, and I'll see you guys next time. Peace.